It's the O Show, the show with the O. It's the O Show, the show with the O. We talk and talk and talk and talk, then we talk some more. It's the O Show, the show with the O. It's the O Show, the show with the O. It's about unconditional self-acceptance, yeah. And sometimes we discover things we did not know.
Oh.
At the O Show. At the O Show.
Good evening. This is the O Show. Business or pleasure? The Right Honourable Talk Show host, Oriana Fox, presiding. All rise.
Hello and welcome to The O Show. I'm your host, Oriana Fox, and we're here today to talk about money, success, and happiness. What's the real connection between these three things, if any? That's the case we're going to attempt to close. It's a bit hot in here. My aim is to cure us all of our money shame. Let's figure out together what really matters. To that end, I put together a fantastic lineup for you tonight. We have three wonderful individuals, each of whom have taken a career path I could have chosen had I not become the talk show host you know and love. We have the socially engaged artist-photographer, Eva Sajovic. We have the art historian and former high-class call girl, Marie-Anne Mancio. And finally, we have the internationally acclaimed Blue Chip Gallery represented artiste, Gavin Turk. I'm so happy that they could be here with us. Now, before we get started talking to our guests, I'd like to give you a little insight into what this topic means to me personally and where I'm coming from. I grew up in Reagan's America, in the financial capital of the country, New York City. I went to a free public school on the Upper East Side. And when I was 9, we went on a class trip to pick apples. We took the apples home and baked pies and cakes and all sorts of goodies to sell at a bake sale. We then used the profit from the bake sale to invest in the stock market. We got to choose which companies to invest in, and throughout the year, we charted our shares ups and downs on graph paper. It was 1987, the year of Black Monday, one of the worst single-day market crashes in history, a foreshadowing of things to come. I don't remember all the details, but I do remember going to a shareholder meeting and a tour at Mattel. And they told us about all the other toy companies that tried to come up with dolls to compete with Barbie. Some people say the market is always right, which is why we've got more Barbies in landfill than living, breathing humans in America. But I digress. When we did finally let go of those stocks, we decided to go on another class trip with our profits. We went out to eat Chinese food and to the movies. And we went to see Big Business, starring Bette Midler and Lily Tomlin. It was actually my second time seeing that film at the movies, and I probably helped convince my class to choose it. What can I say? I'm a big fan of Bette Midler. So I think I should tell you a little bit about the movie because it's quite appropriate to today's topic. Midler and Tomlin play two roles, identical twins, mismatched at birth. One set of twins goes home with New York City dwellers who are very wealthy, and the other pair go home with poor rural West Virginians. They grow up to become business rivals because the rich twins own the company and the land where the poor ones work, and they want to sell it for strip mining. So the poor folks get themselves together to go to New York City to the shareholder meeting and raise some hell. And hilarity ensues. Good triumphs over profit, typical Hollywood propaganda. I still love it and own it on VHS, of course. So fast forward 7 years later, I'm 17, and applying for art school. Unencumbered as I was by practical considerations like having to get a job. Fortunately, or rather due to the many privileges I had been given to pursue my talents and hone my skills, I was one of five shortlisted students competing for one full scholarship. They flew all five of us out to the university to show our portfolios and to be interviewed. And during my interview, they asked me, and I'll never forget it, what is the role of the artist in the community? You want to know what my brilliant response was? I don't know. I don't know. That's what I said. I think it goes without saying I didn't get the scholarship. See, my art was personal. I did it for me. Oh my God. I did it for me. And I didn't care what anyone else thought or what it meant for the community, whatever that was. So I'm recounting these two anecdotes to you because I'm wondering, am I just really narcissistic? Or is it that I've swallowed advanced capitalism's party line, hook, line, and sinker? Have I been socialized to be a self-enclosed, autonomous individual who puts herself first? Or is it that I'm totally self-evolved and there's just no excuse? Some of my excuses. I've been taught to pay attention to what's popular, to idolize fame and the things that money can buy, to compete to get my share, that happiness can be mine if I just work hard enough. At the tender age of 17, the rewards of giving back escaped me, not just that full ride. So I'm still wondering, is it possible to put my tendency to put myself first, to work for the greater good? Is the Osho just another product? What's my motivation? What should it be? Business or pleasure? It's a question that's becoming trickier and trickier to answer. My career defines me. My name is my brand. I network among friends. In love, I won't settle for less. Leisure is work. What arena of life escapes the cost-benefit exercise? Here on the Osho, you've seen me say countless times that the way to overcome negative feelings that almost always accompany the rating game is to unconditionally accept yourself. I am too complicated to be given a single rating. So I choose instead to practice and preach unconditional self-acceptance. That's USA. USA, USA.
USA, 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 USA.
Okay. I always say, you can't rate yourself. You can only rate the things that you do. But that's... there's the rub. Hold the phone. How do you judge the things you do? What criteria do you use? That's where the values and logic of the market can start to creep in. If what you do isn't remunerated or popular, it's all too easy for self-deprecating thoughts to start seeping in. I know that because I'm an artist and I've been there. So, today's show may not solve your financial problems, but I hope it mends the dent that money has made to your pride. So let's come up with some other criteria for judging what we do. Time is money, folks. Let's get this show on the road to success. No, I don't have that in my hand, do I? Continuity error. Okay. Let's get this show on the road to success or elsewhere. I like to call the first defendant to the stand. As I mentioned, she focuses on participatory, socially engaged projects, exploring the drivers of displacement globally, trafficking, climate change, poverty. And the reason I asked her to be here is because of her project called The Roles We Play, which gives agency to people living in poverty. Please join me in welcoming Eva Sajovic.
Don't try to change me in any way. You don't know me.
Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me.
So what brought you to the subject matter that you explore in your work?
Generally, in my work, displacement is a strong kind of line that runs through, which relates, I think, to my own feelings of displacement throughout my life, sort of when I was a child, being half a meter above everybody, kind of familial things, always feeling slightly different from the world around me. And I think that made me want to understand better why that is, and sort of I'm generally interested in people and people's stories, so trying to look at these issues closer is kind of somehow getting to understand myself, the world around me, sort of where am I positioning myself, yeah.
Can you just tell us a little bit more about the project, The Roles We Play?
So The Roles We Play exists as a book, it exists as a website and a touring exhibition. And it's like many of my projects, durational. So I started working on it in 2006-07, a long-term project in collaboration with an organization called ATD Fourth World. They work with poverty kind of around the globe. And the project was kind of came out of an idea that I had that I took to the organization, and then it was very much shaped together with the participants over the years. So it was, that's kind of what for me is very special about it, that it was kind of forged together at all stages, and the participants who are actually themselves experts in poverty were involved in all stages of the project, from concept to through to editing, and also disseminating. The work was also used as an important tool for advocacy. And it's kind of a tool that the activists, as the participants are called or call themselves, were able to really use to push against sort of misrepresentation in the mainstream media, and to kind of tell their story about the roles that they play in society, which are kind of usually very much dumbed down to stereotypical.
Yeah. So how did the portrayals differ in your project from that mainstream media representation?
So because it was all very much based on the process, and the project started as an idea that didn't have any funding, so that was a very different kind of start already. There wasn't any deadline. It just naturally evolved. And it kind of became very much about representation and self-representation and sort of practicing of the self, almost rehearsing for public speaking, where we were able to repeat the takes. If somebody wasn't happy with their photograph or the stories they wrote, they were able to kind of redo that. And that greatly kind of helped grow people's confidence in the kind of in the importance of their voice, that their voice matters, that it's not only the voice of the select few that can kind of speak publicly, which then becomes a political act. It was also achieving a result, and achieving a result on their own terms meant something very different from how people often are treated when they're on benefits or when they live in poverty. You know, there's always one line of narrative that kind of applies. So that was very much reversed, and I think it gave people a lot.
Did anyone feel really nervous about doing that kind of self-representation?
Well, again, I think this is all connected to the nature of the project, which wasn't, you know, we start now and we finish by whatever deadline the funder gives or it's agreed. It was something that grew very organically, and it also meant that I was a constant throughout the 10 years. So, you know, you start to forge friendships, relationships, you kind of start to belong to a group. There is a community that's formed, trust grows. But also a very important aspect was the presence of kind of the structure, which was the organization itself, ATD Fourth World, which is also, I think, really important to stress, in particularly today where organizations are being really eroded, is the existence of a physical space where people can go, and ATD supports people through also, for example, socially, there is a weekly lunch that they organize on a Thursday. So that kind of space also facilitated for that. You know, it's a little bit of scaffolding, background scaffolding, that and, you know, just being constantly present, because as we know, there is very, very little funding, and with that means people in posts change very, very regularly, and also organizations fall apart. But yeah, this was different, and it meant kind of a great deal of support.
Just to say something kind of personal, I often have to do like a lot of psychological work on myself to motivate myself to make art without external support, as I'm sure, I mean, you do. Is there a parallel, or is it too much of a reach to say that it might be the same kind of force or logic or values from capitalism that cause us, like artists and people living in poverty, to feel, I don't know, bad about ourselves? How do you fight that internalized logic of, you know, this thing isn't making money, this thing doesn't have support, this thing isn't popular? Mm-hmm. How do you fight that?
I don't know that I fight it. I mean, the whole.
Or maybe you don't even feel it at all, because.
No, because the way I work, it's not about making money. Obviously, my kind of practice is never going to make money.
Political art is about trying to
effect some sort of change, and even if it's very little, even if it's on the individual basis, like in the roles we play, you know, perhaps the change is grander in the case of individuals
than how the whole situation is going to be affected. Perhaps it's a little kind of push as well.
But I think this comes from sort of from my belief that it is important to try to act upon your values. And I come from
Slovenia, which is part of former Yugoslavia. And kind of, you know, the way I was brought up, and my grandmother was
a really important influence, was with very little, but kind of with a lot of connection with the nature and the world around ourselves, with a strong sense of community where everything was shared out of necessity, but perhaps that kind of became also a way of living. And also because it was all about sustainability, maybe also out of necessity, you know, how do you recycle, how do you reuse, how do you kind of, and you become more innovative in that sense. And for me, that's really important. And it kind of gives you freedom because you don't rely on all the things that are available. You kind of become more, you know, the way artists are, more innovative with things that you have, that perhaps opens much more. And those values today for me are kind of a reaction against the system in which I don't believe, you know, the kind of neoliberal consumptuous world. I despise it, and I try to, as much as it's possible, to stay kind of, try to be on the edge or push against it or try to provoke provoke it, and definitely try to think, how can I stay not co-opted? You know, how can I kind of, and also the question for me at the moment is, what are the forms of political that are going to allow you to not be co-opted? Because immediately, whatever, you know, you're trying to do before you even realize that's happening.
Yeah.
And it's not only connected to money. I think even if you do things that are free, there's always so many different kind of catches that are trying to, you know, turn you into something that somebody wants. And that's why I chose the song that I chose. I don't know whether that answered the question.
I don't know either, because I don't remember the question now. But
does anybody remember the question?
But yeah, so I do have one more thing. I just want you to say something about like the content of what they say. What kinds of things do they take pride in? In their storytelling.
Yeah, in helping a neighbor, in sort of campaigning for the rights, in being able to talk, to relate their story, and taking a lot of pride in kind of gaining the confidence to then relate that story. I kind of don't really want to paraphrase.
Yeah, you don't. We should show the clip.
We should show the clip.
I'm a carer. I help with my mum and I'm very involved in my community. What I do is extremely important to me. I'm actually rather proud of what I do. But in the modern climate, I'm often told that what I do, I should feel shame for, that I'm a burden, that I'm, you know, relying on the state, that I'm skiving, that I should go out and get a proper job, when what I do I consider to be a proper job. I don't see why I should be ashamed of what I do. I'm sick to death of opening papers and being, it feels as though it's like an avalanche of negativity, when actually what I do saves the state a fortune every year. And what I do empowers other people to do what they want to do. I shouldn't have to be ashamed of it. I should be able to be me, do what I do, and be proud of what I do, because what I do is important.
Because I'm disabled now, I'm often accused of not really being disabled, but pretending so that I get more benefits. People assume I do nothing. I get benefits and I do nothing. I contribute nothing. They don't know my life. I've worked hard for most of my life, and even now I do voluntary work. I'm involved in my community. Where and when I can help people, I do. I support people when I can. Because I'm disabled, I have more time than people that are working full time, but I use it. I use it well, I think. It's very frustrating living in poverty. It's very hard. But there's always something that you can do. There's always someone else who's in a worse situation. There's always some way to contribute. And I've always believed that. I've raised my children to believe that. I live in a depressed area that gets a bad reputation, but it's full of other people like myself that are active and involved and doing things. That because it's not paid employment, we're called scroungers and scavengers and scum. And it's very hurtful, it's humiliating, it's annoying. And it's so hard because we don't have the ear of the media. We can't say to people this isn't true. We can't get the message out to other people that because we live in poverty doesn't mean that we have nothing to offer or that we do nothing. communities don't run themselves. We run communities.
Yeah, so I mean, to me, they are revaluing themselves on a certain basis, like of being productive citizens in a sense, or caring citizens. And I just wonder about those people who don't have something story like that to tell, like, or who aren't able to do those things. So I mean,
yeah.
But maybe that's something that we could talk about in the panel discussion.
Yeah, I'll just say one thing. It's, I think, you know, everybody's got something to share. I strongly believe that. I don't believe that there is people who have got less to share. I think that's kind of almost, shouldn't we turn the question around?
Yes. Please do.
What are the expectations? Maybe the expectations are wrong. If there are expectations in the first place, I think that's perhaps wrong. If that makes sense.
Yeah. But it's hard to live without fulfilling any or and feel good about yourself without fulfilling any kind of normative expectations, I think.
But what the people talk about is not necessarily normative.
Or just maybe not normative. Little, it's like
little moments in life that matter on a daily basis. It doesn't need to be something that is, and on whose norms? I think those are all questions that I find quite, limiting.
Yeah. Okay. We'll have to discuss it with the panel. Thank you so much for being here. Someone remarked of my next guest that she lives her life like she's making it up as she goes along. Her career has taken twists and turns. She has a PhD in performance art, and she's lectured in art history for quite a while. But as she was preparing for her viva for her PhD, she decided to moonlight as a hostess for London's Crazy Horse Club. Please join me in welcoming Marie-Anne Mancio. Can you just give me a kind of potted history of your career?
Wow, okay.
Just very, very briefly.
Very briefly.
Very brief.
So after finishing my BA in, as you said, performance art, live art practice, I then started lecturing in art history and went on to do a PhD and applied for a job at Goldsmiths teaching critical theory. And at this point, I was like, okay, I've got a first-class degree, I'm finishing a PhD, I've got lecturing experience, and I didn't even get an interview. So I got quite disillusioned with this whole notion of I want to be an academic. And one of my students, funnily enough, was talking to me about how she'd been a hostess in a club in Japan and how easy it was, and all you had to do is drink champagne and so on. So when I saw an advertisement in the Evening Standard for the Crazy Horse Nice Club, I thought, yeah, I can do this. I'm going to go and see what it's about. And at that point, I was really interested in postmodern theory and ideas about identity and the work of Sophie Cal and Cindy Sherman, all of those artists. And I thought that, in a sense, this was an extension of what I've been doing in live art. It's a performance, you know, it's you're taking on an identity. So I got to the club, I had an interview, and the manager was very strict, and he said, you know, all you have to do, you get paid if clients come in and drink champagne with you, but whatever you do, you don't leave with them. I was like, no, obviously, no, you don't leave with them. And then in the dressing room that night, the other girls working there said, well, make sure you ask for £300 and no less if you're leaving. So then I was like, okay, maybe this isn't quite just sitting there drinking champagne. And I really thought about it at that point and thought, well, I'm just going to see what happens and make the decision at the last moment whether I'm going to go or not go if somebody asks me. And try to put out of my head all of my preconceptions about prostitution, sex work, etc. and question all of those things. And I did and still do identify as a feminist, and it really troubles me and upsets me that so many feminists are anti-sex work. And even the Women's Equality Party at the moment has a very strong anti-sex work line. So having done that for a while, there was then, I think, an article that came out, something came out, and I can't remember what, that annoyed me. And I thought, I want to write an article about my experiences. And I thought that the Guardian Women's page would be the perfect place for it. And they rejected it because, of course, it didn't fit their narrative that all sex workers were exploited. So I sent it to The Independent on Sunday and they published it. And then it kind of exploded. And this is pre-internet, really. This is, I should say, 22 years ago, long time now. I suddenly was getting asked to go onto chat shows and write more articles and give interviews and tried to advocate in the way that a small way I could for sex workers. And I did that job for about 11 months. And then I think the hedonistic lifestyle starts to catch up with you. So I think there was certainly at least one occasion, and I probably can say this now because it's so many years ago, that I remember going from a night out, you know, still dressed in the heels and the long dress and having caned it all night, straight into lecture the next morning to give a talk about postmodernism. And that's probably when I realized I don't know how sustainable it is to keep these two things going simultaneously, just because one is living at night. You know, you were you didn't finish work before 3 a.m. So by the time you've unwound and gone home and you're sleeping in the day, so then to get up and go and give a lecture, yeah, wasn't great.
But you should just tell us what you do now.
And what I do now.
Yeah.
Yes.
What you do now.
Yeah, I now run art history tours, study tours abroad, and take people to the Venice Biennale and also around London looking at, in particular, looking at contemporary art. And in a way, I don't feel that these two are totally disparate things, because I feel that some of the skills that you learn doing the kind of work that I did are applicable now, because essentially it's about keeping people entertained. It's about reading people. I think that's really important, the ability to read a person and to you know, see how people mix together, how do they mingle together, all these kinds of ideas. And also ultimately to give some kind of pleasure, really, that's what you're doing. Yeah. Because part of my job was as a hostess was to entertain. You know, you had to sit at the table and get through two bottles of champagne before we were allowed to leave that nightclub. So that's a lot of talking and drinking, or pretending to drink, because we would chuck the champagne on the carpet or in the plant pot, because you just can't sustain that level of alcohol.
I just want to say, though, you mentioned Sophie Cal,
yes.
And it's quite funny because on the previous O Show about masculine sexuality, one of the guests also said he was inspired by Sophie Cal. So, Sophie, I know you're probably watching. Your career has led to a lot of promiscuity because that guest on that show slept with 365 people, one for every day of the year. But so anyway, I just wanted to mention that. So you said you did it for around a year and you stopped because you couldn't sustain the two. Did you tell your clients about these identities,
yes.
Two identities and
good
the co-workers
question.
And yeah.
Yes. Well, my clients refused to believe that I could possibly have a PhD. I remember one of them saying to me, oh, you seem quite bright. You could get a job as a secretary. And I was just thinking, why would I want to be your secretary? I was so, no offense to secretaries because they do an amazing job. But, you know, it was that patronizing nature that people couldn't believe that you could possibly be these two things simultaneously. At work, I had some amazing supportive colleagues, because if you have anything to do with art or art history, you know, so many models throughout art history, you know, so many paintings wouldn't have been made without sex workers modeling for them, from Caravaggio to Degas, you know, there's millions. But even then, my students at the time thought that the whole thing was an elaborate performance piece. So when I ended up having given an interview to The Sun of all publications, there was a double page spread in The Sun. They thought, oh wow, it's a performance piece, because I suppose it was also coinciding in the late 90s with that kind of bad girls movement, Sarah Lucas, Tracy Emin, and so on. So it was a slightly schizophrenic way of living, this sort of double life, really.
Do you answer the question, though, about why you gave it up? You said that it was because of the two roles, but was there something else?
Also, I think that, you know, it's a great job if you're single, but if you wanted to get into any kind of relationship, it was difficult. And I did meet women who were in relationships, but some of them, you know, the men didn't realise what they did. They literally thought they came to the club and sat and drank champagne, or that they danced at the club. Some of them went so far as to pretend that they were waitressing in the restaurant opposite the club, and their partners would drop them off outside the restaurant, and they would have their evening dresses in their bags and then have to do a quick change. So I didn't want to have that kind of extra added duplicity involved. I thought, what you also find is, because you're treated so well in that job, or there's no way I would have put up with somebody treating me badly when I was doing that work, that then, in theory, you should carry that over into your personal relationships and think, well, why am I going to let someone treat me badly when they're not paying me? When, you know, that I didn't let them treat me badly when they were paying me for my time and my company. So it's quite interesting, the repercussions of that. I think also what was interesting in terms of this notion of feeling exploited and this belief that you must somehow be exploited, and how difficult it is to feel exploited when you're being paid £300 an hour. Because I get paid that now sometimes to give a lecture, and that's a hell of a lot more work that goes into that, in a sense, than going out to dinner with someone and actually having sex with them.
Yeah. So would you say you found it kind of empowering?
Totally, yeah. And I think it definitely changed lots of things. Confidence, I would even say now I'm still quite shy as a person naturally. But the idea that you're performing, and also because of the way that we had to dress, so there was quite a strict dress code. You couldn't, you know, you weren't meant to look like the archetypal prostitute. So no knee-high boots, no mini skirts. It was really like long evening gowns. If you even wanted to go the whole hog with gloves, you could do it. You know, it was more Breakfast at Tiffany's, let's say. And that kind of dress up automatically gave you a kind of presence and a confidence. And then, like I say, this fact that being in that scenario, meeting people from lots of different walks of life who would be considered very important in their sphere. So I've never named names, but a rock star, a comedian, a golf player, you know, people that in their sphere would know their names, let's say. But when you're meeting them in that situation, you're on an equal playing field and you don't feel in any way intimidated. So afterwards, you don't feel fazed by meeting anybody in particular. And also going to those places, I think, after being a student or living that kind of life where you're always scrabbling around for money, to suddenly, being taken to places that you wouldn't have access to, which I think is interesting, and just having a glimpse of what it's like to be very moneyed, which I found quite fascinating.
Yeah, yeah, but there's no pension plan.
No, there's no pension. And that does, and yes, and many women, I think, in that job, you do become a bit hedonistic, because it's easy come, easy go with the money as well, because you never knew how the day was going to end, and that was quite exciting, that you'd go into work and you might be on your last 20 quid and then you come out with 500, you know, like suddenly from one extreme to the other. So yes. You weren't always as careful about saving it as you probably should have been.
So I think it's really fascinating that you found it to be empowering, like especially in your relationships, because there's this assumption that prostitution cheapens something, that puts a price on something that should be priceless.
I think that's one of the misconceptions, because there's no way that I'm saying that, you know, sex can be an amazing thing, and sex between two people that have a really strong connection and find each other really gorgeous is a different thing. But also I think that there is the equivalent of a detached touch. So for instance, if you go for a smear test, if you go to the doctors to have your breast checked for lumps, you know, you're not expecting them to get aroused when they're touching you. And I think you can create or learn that similar kind of detachment where you are not being you, really. You're, you know, it's a professional persona, and you can give pleasure to someone without going through all of the other emotions that that you know you might when you're having sex with someone you really care about or someone you find really attractive, for instance.
And it's not that different from, say, like a one-night stand.
Well, no, I think this is the irony, isn't it, that I found really difficult that, you know, if you're doing it for free, then somehow that's fine. But if you're charging for it, then it isn't fine. And I couldn't understand that. And I saw it almost like in the 70s, there was this wages for housework campaign, you know, where women were saying, well, what about all this housework, all this domestic labor that we're always the ones that end up doing, and it's just taken for granted that we do it, and it's free, you know, it's free labor. If you had to hire a cleaner, you'd be paying X, Y, Z. And you think, wow, you know, can you imagine if the revolution, if women started charging for sex in that way, because they're feeling that they're not getting much, you know, it's not an equal relationship. And what I was hearing from men is that they often feel they are paying for sex, but they're not paying in cash. So they're having to buy a woman dinner three times, or they got the wife a new washing machine, you know, literally that there was some implicit exchange going on there. That was a form of prostitution that wasn't discussed in that way.
Yeah. Also, I realized that in my introduction for you, I forgot to mention that you've written a novel.
I have written it.
Called Horticulture, and it's not just about flowers.
No.
So that's very much influenced or informed by your experiences. So
yes.
I think that kind of comes across in the characters, like some marry clearly for for money and for kind of a salvation almost, because anyway. Well,
yeah. So I tried to do in horticulture was to look historically, because one of the things that fascinated me when I was looking at sex work, when I was starting, you know, I was like, I want to read everything. I want to kind of find the history of it, in a sense. And so I wrote that novel set in the 19th century, but realized that so much was the same. So for example, you know, women working in brothels in the 19th century, they would sell the clients colored water, pretending it was whiskey, sell it at inflated prices, you know. And there we were in the club, you know, selling this rather cheap champagne for these ludicrously inflated prices and throwing it in the pot plants. So nothing changes. The tricks and the personas, everything, you know, has repeated. And I was quite interested to look at how prostitution manifests in different circumstances.
Yeah, yeah. It makes me think of that line from Gentlemen Prefer Blondes. Marilyn Monroe says, "A man being rich is just like a girl being pretty." You wouldn't marry a girl just because she's pretty, but it sure helps.
It sure helps.
She says that to try to convince her father-in-law she's not marrying his son just for his money.
And that's another good point as well, because I think, you know, growing up, I never thought of myself, I was never like the pretty one. So it also was fascinating to me to see, you know, who were these women? What were these women that men would pay to have sex with? And this notion that they all look like supermodels is just not the case. It's not that. It's about something else. It's about them having a space, I think, creating a space or wanting to create a space that is a space away from their work concerns, their domestic concerns. They don't have to think about the mortgage or their children for 2 seconds. They can just have this very selfish, in some ways, fantasy time with somebody who's there with no connection. And you don't have to look, you know, you didn't have to look a certain way. All you had to do was to understand what it was that they wanted and to be the person that they wanted you to be for that evening. And that's quite fascinating, because you become almost like a cipher that they're projecting their fantasies onto.
And did they ask for any kinky stuff?
Always, but no, not always. No, I mean, they were very, I think, do you know what? I think most of the time it's much more normal than people think. And it's the talking about doing it rather than the doing it that was exciting for men. And I do remember one time with one girl that I feel really bad now. We ended up with £1,000 each that night, and we didn't even take our coats off because the guy got out his cocaine and that was it. The night was gone, talking, you know, gone. And then we were like, oh, we're off the clock. That's it now. Time's up. Bye. I felt kind of sorry for him because he'd spent all this money to try and fulfill some great sexual fantasy. And then he'd got sidetracked.
It's interesting what you say, the comparison to housework, and, you know, that you really had to listen to and hear their stories, and you provide a kind of affective labor. But it's interesting how we demonize prostitution, but other forms of affective labor,
exactly.
You know, although lesser paid,
yes.
are not demonized, or you don't say a therapist is,
yes.
You know.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I think you are a kind of therapist. I think the worst night I ever had in that job was listening to someone telling me about their child that had been killed by a drunk driver. And that's what I did all night, listened to their grief. So that is like being a therapist, really. Because it's so stigmatized and because so many people can't be open because their families are not so liberal or they're working for companies perhaps that are not so liberal. You know, I'm self-employed now, so it's a bit different. It retains this air of mystique and also is something quite seedy. And none of the conversations are had. They're not very articulate the way that people speak about prostitution. I think it's not. We haven't moved on.
Well, you've been very articulate.
Well,
thank you so much.
Thank
you. We're gonna. I look forward to speaking to you more. My next guest is a pioneering and daring artist who's garnered international acclaim. As I said before, he's represented by a blue chip gallery. That means his work is a sound investment, which is interesting because the very nature of his work is to question the notion of value and the identity of the artist. Please put your hands together for Gavin Turk. Thank you so much for being here. Are we ready for me to say that? I paused this time. Yeah? Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
So for those who are uninformed of your work, can you just say a little bit about some pieces that relate to the topic of today's show?
I thought you were going to do that. I thought you were going to say a few bits about some other works.
No, I wanted you to do that.
I have to do that.
Yeah.
Talk about my work.
Please.
You did it quite well with the idea that, you know, my work quite often...
When did I do anything?
Well, when
oh,
you
just now,
me,
okay.
I think that was the idea. I mean,
okay.
Like, I don't know. I mean, I left school and did a foundation course. I left the foundation course, did a BA in art. Then I did an MA in art. Then I failed my MA, and that was a big cause célèbre. I showed like a blue plaque celebrating my time at the Royal College, and I failed. And then I got in the newspapers, and it was all a big story.
Uh-huh.
But this was in 1991. It was a long time ago.
Yes,
really,
you're one of our YBAs.
Then, but even back then, you know, like the you know, for me, like my art was really about trying to question what the point of art was, you know, what were the values that we were working with, what qualified as an artist, what qualified as an artwork, like how do we define it, you know? I mean, I think this is fantastic sitting on your chat show, which is a kind of bona fide art, which is an artwork. I mean, we're taking part. I'm taking part in your performance. We're all taking part in this kind of art experiment, and art can be this as well. And I think that possibly when, you know, in 1991 when I was, you know, leaving my MA, I wasn't sure, this was something I was looking forward to. It was something that I thought that, you know, that there was possibilities, and so. I've always tried, and I still try to, you know, be quite experimental in my work, and I try to not, you know, I still go to a party and someone says, so what do you do? And I say, I'm an artist, and they say, oh, what kind of art do you make? I mean, even having said I'm an artist, I go, because I can see them going, you know, then they say, what materials do you work in? I'm like, and I say things like ideas, and they go like, oh, right, so is it like, so what does that mean? It's very difficult. Once you say you're an artist, it's like, oh, right. The preconceptions start coming in. Once you say this is an artwork, you know, the preconceptions start coming in. So I'm kind of trying as much as I can to step outside the box as much as being in the box. You know, classic sculptures that I make, someone like forces me to say, you know, okay, well, what work, you know, are you, what's your favorite work that you've made? And I say, well, I made a bag of, a filled black bag of rubbish, and then I painted it to look like it was, I've made it in bronze and then painted it to look like it was a filled bag of rubbish. So when you walk into a room, you think, oh, what's that rubbish doing here? And it's like, obviously the joke is like, art is rubbish. And, you know, and there's already a kind of like, there's a disjunct, there's a kind of like, oh, this is the thing that we're throwing away, this is the thing we don't want, this is the thing that has no value. But ultimately, like, this is a thing that's like full of love, care and attention. It's very kind of meticulously made. It deals with trompe l'oeil, it deals with surface, it deals with colour, shade, reflection, it deals with holes, it deals with absence, it deals with really like the anti-portrait. It's like what in effect, like what we are. It's like a portrait of our society, like that we become what we throw away. And, you know, like it's one of the major kind of global concerns at the moment is like the idea of litter or rubbish or about waste. I mean, humans are great, but they do require a lot of materials, which essentially they require those materials to waste those materials. I mean, one of the classic ones is actually going to the supermarket and buying black bin liners. You know, you buy a roll of black bin liners, and the point of buying those is actually that those are going to be the things that you throw away. You just literally buy them to throw them away. I mean, they are the thing, that the means, the process of throwing stuff away. I think also for me, in an art gallery, when I have a black bag there, you know, maybe it becomes a performative thing. You initiate a situation where someone comes into a gallery and they look at someone looking at a black bin liner, and that becomes art. It's like, oh God, art's a really weird thing. I went into a gallery the other day and I saw someone staring at a bin liner. You know, and as much as anything, art may be a chance to ask questions about what you think is valuable, what you think is important, what you think is sort of real in a way. And, you know, it has the possibility to ask questions of the maker and the audience, because I think at some point the audience becomes the artist as well.
I just interrupt you for a second?
Sure, interrupt
away. I heard that you went to the Sensation private view dressed as a tramp.
That's true, that happened.
And what happened?
Well, I sneaked in and the Sensation exhibition was hailed as, it was Charles Saatchi's showing of his art collection. It was a private art collection being shown at the Royal Academy. It wasn't a curated show per se. I think for the private view, I had one invitation. And, you know, I think the artists were kind of, the artists themselves were quite backgrounded. And also I thought, you know, this is strange, this sort of celebration, this idea of kind of arriving into the establishment of artists. Like, it felt kind of odd to me. It felt kind of adjacent to some of the kind of elements and things that I was doing in my work. So I ended up dressing up as a tramp. I mean, I was working in the West End. I had a studio in the Charing Cross Road. Like, I knew lots of people living on the streets. You know, I would spend a lot of time with people who were there living rough sleeping. And so it was a sort of a daily occurrence to be with people like that, and I ended up kind of dressing up and behaving and just sort of and sort of managed to sneak into the exhibition like dressed like a tramp, and people were kind of confused. Some people thought that actually I was quite down on my luck and, you know, maybe, you know, some bad things had happened. Other people thought it was an art performance. Some people like wanted to come and interfere and talk to me, and other people wanted to avoid me. Some people wanted to push me over to, like, you know, see me with, you know, in the context of other people. I mean, this was 1995. It was still probably not the, you know, not everyone was taking pictures every 5 seconds, you know. I think that, you know, it was still something where some photographs were taken, but not it wasn't a photographic moment. It was still a very kind of lived in the real moment. But I think really, you know, and I don't think it was art. I think what I was doing at the time, I think I was just doing a kind of it was a sort of dressing up. It was like a costume party. It was like everyone was dressing up, so I dressed up. Well, I dressed down, but dressed up down.
Right.
You know? I mean, yeah. That was it, really. Yeah. I mean, later on, maybe a year later, I made a sculpture of me as the tramp, as the homeless guy, and so it later on became a kind of. Later on, I made a sculpture of that moment, but it took me a year to realise that possibly what I did before was. What was actually something to do with art.
So, yeah, I can see some real connections between your work, the themes of your work, and Eva's work that she talked about. But I also really feel like that you and I have a lot in common as artists. And it's mainly to do with using our work as a form of self-invention. Mm-hmm. And also, you copy works by other mm-hmm. artists, and you tend to copy mm-hmm. iconic white mm-hmm. male artists, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. whereas I tend to copy, or at least in the past, I've tended to copy virtually, like almost unknown or lesser known feminist performance artists working in the late 60s and early 70s and maybe 80s. I'm just wondering, like, do you think that's something to do with the difference in our level of success?
I can't speak for you. I mean, I just think for me, it was possibly that, you know, and it is highly questionable, but I think it was to do with the fact that I was understanding that art history itself was imposing such a huge kind of preeminence on anything that artists were making now was how it was looking, how it was being read, like in a way, like that art history forms a kind of filter through which your art was being read. And I think that at that time, obviously, I think that things are changing, but I think at the time I was kind of thinking, well, like this kind of very archetype white male art history is a kind of filter through which my art, as a, you know, possibly as a white Anglo-Saxon Protestant male, I'm not Protestant, not religious at all, but maybe that might be that it might be read through those things. So I was sort of trying to kind of, rather than have that filter be put invisibly in front of the work, I was sort of going like, well, let's just go straight there, and let's just go straight to it, and let's just have that conversation straight away, and let's say that art is a system, a language. It's built through pre-existing works. And so those works do affect the audience. They already the audience has got certain kinds of ideas of what they think of as masterpieces, or as surrealist, or as Dadaist, or as that there are kind of aesthetics that are in operation, and those aesthetics possibly are signatured by other people. You know, if you make a piece of art and it's made of like a lump of fat or lard or something, then everyone might look and say, "Ah, oh, is this by Joseph Beuys?" As if he has a sort of ability to signature material. And similarly, like this kind of idea is like imbuing signature on on aesthetics, like happens throughout our history. I mean, it's I guess it's the way that art gets kind of arranged. But I mean, in your case,
your
in relationship with your, I think, you know, that it's about influence, I suppose. It's about finding finding structures, props, places of recognition where you can find yourself, where you can realise yourself through an understanding of a kind of history that you see or that you can understand. I mean, and you read it in the way that you personally will read it.
Is yeah.
I don't know if I don't know how I did with you, but I did me.
You once said something like
I love these.
The best art is the one that most people misunderstand or.
I mean, I think it was about the idea of like the greatest art is the art that can be most misunderstood or misunderstood by the greatest amount of people. It's like the point is that people have and bring their own sense of values and importance to things. They are able to enjoy and share in celebrating the same things, the same objects, the same art objects. But they obviously all do it in their own special way, in their own way.
So I'm just wondering, do you think the market's always right when it comes to your work? Are the most, you know, are the pieces that garner the most money the ones you like the best?
It's difficult, isn't it, if we talk about the market. You know, the market is really weird. I mean, art if I think about the market in relationship to art, one of the things that art is able to do is it's able to be something that can go from the smallest amount of value and money, it can go from free to very small amount of money for, I think sometimes, great art, to the most expensive thing that money couldn't even buy. Like, it's like literally culture. It's like there's no financial money that could be amassed on the planet together to actually buy that particular thing. So art is something that has the ability to span this sort of sense of money, in a way the fantasy of money. But the notion of the market itself is really strange because, I come across people and they are buying price tags. They'll go to an auction and they won't put their hand up and they won't even look unless something's like more than £500,000. That if it's under that, they're not interested. And in the way what they do, so they're just literally buying the price tag. They buy the price tag. So, but in a way, by doing that and by going high like that, what they're doing is they're saying, well, the art world, whatever that is, the art world is vetting the prices, is allowing this price, is allowing Christie's, Sotheby's, or wherever it is, to put this price tag on there. So they're just saying, oh, well, the groundwork's been done, so this then will be an investment. Coming back to me and my work, I don't know about the market at all. I mean, like, the market is similar to this question of success and how you evaluate your own, how I evaluate my own work. Well, I've made lots of work that I feel is incredibly good and I'm very comfortable with, and people and the audience aren't that bothered about it. They don't get it or it's too easy. It's been too easy and they don't appreciate that. Sometimes I have work and I find it quite awkward and I'm kind of a little bit embarrassed about it, but you know, you find that there's an audience that loves that. They love that fact. You know, they know that there's something that of you that you've put in there that you're not sure you want to let go of. So there's some awkwardness there, and that can be, you know, that can be marketed. That can be good. But I definitely don't think the market is right. it's certainly not always right. You know, I mean, probably never right. You know, I'm definitely, I make my art under the basis or under the kind of the cloak that I'm going to make something that at the moment of making it has the potential of value. But obviously, as I make it, it has no value at all. It just literally has the value of being like something that made me laugh or smile, or kind of like when ideas came together and I thought that'll be a great thing.
Like the biscuit.
The biscuit. What do you mean, like the biscuit?
The biscuit that you bit into and
yeah. Like a biscuit.
Yeah.
The cue, the slide of the biscuit. Biscuit.
There's the biscuit, everybody. Yeah, so I think of blue chip artists as in some ways...
Blue suit artists
as in some ways like lottery winners. Like, not to say that there's not been any hard work or talent or that's gone into where you got to.
But yeah.
Do you agree?
I think there's a point like where I mean, it's difficult to evaluate it. I mean, I know that of my peer group, like... I probably am not, I'm certainly not the most expensive, but so what am I saying? Come on, say this properly. cut, start again. I think that I am able to get good prices for my art, and that it enables me to carry on and function. And unfortunately, I've set up a scenario with a studio and with assistants and a life which actually requires that to happen. It's part of the system that now I'm involved in, that my work
unfortunately
has a certain, well, it's unfortunate because it's in a sense it's sort of, it all neutralizes itself. I mean, I could go back to, like, you know, just me in the garret, you know, kind of signing crisp packets and throwing them out the window and, you know. I mean, I'm very nervous about this idea of entitlement. I mean, I think that every artwork should, when it comes out of the studio, have to work its way right up to the top, like on its own, you know, in its own way. But at the same time, you know, I think that art is about audience and the financial element of the artwork actually makes and creates audience. I know it sounds really banal, and I have a very small little story which I say, which is that early on in my career I had some drawings on the floor in my studio, and a friend came round to my studio to visit me who didn't know anything about art. And he kicked one of the pictures, and it fell down. I said, "Please, you know, don't break that, because I don't actually own it. Someone else has bought that off me." And he said, "Someone bought that, like that. It was a scribbly signature in a frame. I mean, agreed. There wasn't much to it, but someone had bought it." And he said, "How much did you get for it?" I said, "I got £500. He said, £500. And he ran, he grabbed it, and he stared at it, silent. Like this guy who wasn't interested in art. He never really looked at anything. Like, if I asked him today what that art was, he'd be able to remember it perfectly. Because when I told him about the money, he went and he looked. So the money element, for him, made him look.
Right.
And it was interesting for me as an education, because I went, wow, you know, that the money element is making people look. So and the more people look, the more audience things get, you know, somehow, like, the more they become art. Because the audience as well, like, they're the artists. Art is made with audience in mind. It's not, I think it is, you know, about audience engagement. It's not, you know, I think the artist on the desert island fiddling around, I don't think it's art. I think it's just fiddling around. You know, it needs a boat to come, you know, and people to land on the island and kind of like tramp around and go, "Oh, what's this? Oh, you know, art." You know, they make it art. The audience makes it art. And I think that you know, there's a point like where you know, the financial element can make the audience look, you know, and looking is good. I mean, but it can make the audience not look, which is what I was saying before. I mean, like, sometimes the audience, they look at the price tags and they don't look at the art, you know, so sometimes it can make people overlook, and that's what we need to avoid as well. So sometimes we're trying to, I'm trying to stop people and say, actually, no, you know, really look in a different way.
If you didn't make money on your art, what would you continue making it?
If I didn't make money from my art, would I continue?
Or you didn't have,
I mean, quite honestly, I still try to believe in that idea that if I could think of something better to do with my life, I'd go and do it. I mean, I love it, what I'm doing with making art and how it works, and I have grown into that process. If you ask me, like, what happens when everyone hates me and no one buys any of my work anymore, and it has no value, do I carry on making it? If I can't think of something better to do, I will. I'll carry
okay,
on doing it.
All right. Good answer. Okay, great. Let's thank Gavin Turk for being with us.